I'm not in Campfire Girls. I'm a brownie.
Miss Jennifer's graduation.
That's Michael Keaton playing a workaholic who needs to be in two places at one time, and he can be after he's cloned in the new comedy Multiplicity. I'm Roger Ebert of the Chicago Sun-Times.
And I'm Gene Siskel of the Chicago Tribune. Multiplicity starts out with a terrific comic premise. Michael Keaton is harried at work, harried at home. He needs a couple of helping hands, preferably two that look exactly like his own, and he gets them from a mad scientist. And the special effects in this picture are compelling, too, as Keaton and his clone decide how they'll divvy up the work in his life.
Yeah, boy, between the two of us, we're going to get a lot of stuff done. We're going to kick some ass. We're going to be awesome. Ted.
We're going to destroy Ted.
We must bring Ted down.
Yes,
we must crush Ted.
Yes.
I want to get Ted.
Talk to me. Talk to me.
And I will break his little neck. Now, Chesney, come on. Oh, yeah. Yes.
Yeah. Laura's home.
Hey, Law!
Hey, honey!
That's Andy McDowell as Keaton's wife. Multiplicity begins to get routine, however, in its scenes of comic confusion. For example, when Keaton and his clone wind up in the same restaurant. And here, through a mix-up, the macho clone, known as Two, ends up with Andy McDowell, while Keaton is stuck with the clone's date.
Oh, come on, this way.
Hey!
Oh, sorry.
Hey, that's
right,
Colonel.
Multiplicity becomes more provocative when one clone simply doesn't solve all of Keaton's problems.
Hi, how are you?
Hey, how are you?
Are you nuts? Are you mentally nuts?
No, look.
I have the whole thing figured out. Aw, man, what do we need him for?
Well, he's going to help me with the kids, and he's going to help me around the house. And I figured when you weren't busy with work or whatever, you guys could hang out together.
This latest clone, known as Three, embodies a more sensitive soul. But I kept wondering if Keaton was playing him as gay. The script of Multiplicity isn't that daring.
Make sure we're even, and then I fold once. I fold twice, or three times, whatever you need to fold it. But I don't like to roll it. Sometimes people just roll it over, but I don't like that, because then you get that lump right across the center. It rolls around in the fridge and everything. I like to fold it down so it's nice and neat, flat, and no air goes in there, because what? Air's our enemy, isn't it?
Again, once the premise of an overworked husband is exhausted in Multiplicity, it's simply the special effects that hold our attention.
We tried, Doug. We really did. It was a nightmare. She was unstoppable, Doug. It was unbelievable. It's like she couldn't get set.
She touched my peppy, Steve.
And yes, there's another clone. I suppose I've said it more than once in this review, Multiplicity, a terrific premise that loses its originality the longer it goes on, concluding, in fact, quite badly with two wimpy endings. I really enjoyed the first couple of reels of Multiplicity, but a mixed review, thumbs down for me.
Thumbs down for me too, Gene. And you know, this movie was directed by Harold Ramis,
right,
who wrote the original National Lampoon's Animal House, who used to be one of the anarchic spirits at Second City in Chicago, who's been involved in movies like Ghostbusters,
sure,
and who here plays it completely safe. There was idea in this movie, really, that couldn't be right at home in a sitcom or a made-for-TV comedy. It seems to me that there are all kinds of ways to take this premise and to push it into dangerous and daring areas,
right,
where the comedy, as you put it, really has something that it's risky.
Well, I mean, when this started, I thought, you know, they're really on to something,
mm-hmm,
because obviously men are stressed out at home and at work, just like women are stressed, mm-hmm, out who are working at home as well. But beyond that, as you say, it doesn't go
well. For example,
anywhere.
Everybody's curious, obviously, about what's going to go on in bed between Andy McDowell and these four husbands that she doesn't realize she has. Obviously, there are things you could do with that to have insights into some of the humor and some of the realities of marital sex that they're not even interested
in. That would be the most exploitive thing. You could even do it at the workplace.
Not exploitive. You could do it cleverly.
Okay.
I'm not talking about exploitive sex.
This doesn't do it, obviously.
Okay, next movie. And our next movie is The Frighteners, a nonstop gore fest that has special effects from wall to wall and even in the walls, because the walls contain the Grim Reaper himself pushing through the wallpaper. The movie starts as a sort of Ghostbusters comedy, turns into a horror film, and ends up as an action picture, and it isn't very good at any one of those things. As it begins, Michael J. Fox is the local Ghostbuster. He gets a lot of business, mainly because he works with three real ghosts who drum up business for him. Trini Alvarado and Peter Dobson play the new local residents who have a ghost problem.
Did the bed levitate?
Yeah, with me on it.
Spontaneous recurrent psychokinesis.
Oh, boy. Oh, this could be the worst case I've ever seen.
Shy McBride and Jim Fife play two of Fox's resident ghosts who are trapped between life and death and kill time by scaring victims.
All right, kid, quit jumping around and acting like a baby. This is serious. Now, we're going to scare the living daylights out of your parents. So, come on, kid, you going to help us out?
Are you with us?
See? He gets it. The kids always get it.
Let's go.
All right.
Hi! Mrs. Potterfields!
The third of Fox's ghosts is the judge, played by John Astin.
Give it up, Frank. Death ain't no way to make a living.
And here's an example of still more special effects. Watching this movie, I had one overwhelming feeling. They went to an enormous amount of trouble for very little payoff. The Frighteners was directed by Peter Jackson, who made Heavenly Creatures, that movie about the two young New Zealand girls who become murderers after being seduced by the fantasy world that they create. This movie is a big step backwards.
Absolutely true. In fact, I really, you know, this picture really bothered me because it was ugly, it was mean. I don't know what Michael J. Fox is doing with his career in this picture. Did he think this was sort of being hip? It's like a good guy went to the other side and aligned himself with the forces of evil. And what I mean by forces of evil, I'm just talking about this unhappy cutting up of people and deformity. It was unpleasant to sit through this film.
Well, Michael Fox is the hero of this film. I mean, he's not one of the bad guys.
But I'm talking about this project.
Yes, it's not pleasant to look at.
No.
It's not interesting to follow. It doesn't go anywhere.
No.
And it's not about anything.
No, it is
it's like a mean picture. You know what it is? Like a demo reel for special effects. You could show this to somebody to show what you could do if you wanted to get a job.
My point is that Michael J. Fox has allied himself previously with good entertainment. Mm-hmm. This is junk. Coming up next, Shaquille O'Neal shoots for a movie career in the comic fantasy Kazaam.
You realize who I am? I'm your genie! Who dare to wake me? Ain't gonna make this a mystery.
Shaquille O'Neal plays a rapping genie who comes to the aid of a boy who needs a father figure in Kazaam, a picture that wastes the comic talent, geniality and charisma of the giant basketball star. First of all, listing all the things that go wrong in this film, the little boy that the genie is supposed to help is an obnoxious bratty type played by a very showbiz child movie actor, Francis Capra. He gets no sympathy from me.
Make your three wishes!
Go away! Leave me alone!
I'm gonna kick your butt!
Come on, loser!
No way I'm losing this race, buddy!
Next problem, the genie. He simply isn't very magical. His special effects seem cheesy.
I'm back! Take a break, kid. You're gonna need it for this.
Woo! Don't get all hysterical.
Say thank you for your miracle.
How about the story? It's dreadfully boring. It involves the kid trying to reunite his parents, including an absent father who is a thief. But most of the dialogue between the kid and the genie is tiresome, in-your-face, who can be more insulting humor.
So, until I make those last two wishes, I own you, don't I?
Technically.
Welcome to my life. And here's a tip. What's the point of shoes?
I think the story would have been improved considerably if, let's say, Shaq had been cast as a real-life basketball star who becomes a de facto genie as he befriends a kid after a basketball game and very much wants to grant him some wishes. The bottom line on Shaquille O'Neal, the actor, and Kazaam, coming on the heels of his previous film, Blue Chips, Shaq needs a coach for his movie projects as well as his free throws. It's a bad movie.
Well, I thought he was better, and I thought Blue Chips was better.
It is.
I didn't think he was better in this, though. I agree with you about Kazaam. It's a waste of time. Why in the world did they think that any kids, and this is obviously a kid movie, would care about a plot where the father is a thief who's trying to pirate stolen musical tapes?
Right.
What kid can identify with that?
It's not exciting. I got a news for you. Tapes and discs, the other big... These are boring props to have in action pictures.
They sure, and here's another thing that bothered me. In this entire movie, there is never the thought that the movie would have existed if they hadn't had Shaquille O'Neal. Right. It's like they hired him and they said, oh, he's tall, bald, and black. Let's make him a genie. Right. They never thought... Do we have the right role for him? Can we do anything other than plug him into totally predictable assembly line cliches taken right off the
show?
Now,
here's a test, though, because he is a very likable, charming
guy.
Sure
he is, yeah.
I would say to this, to him, if they hand you a script, ask yourself, would you pay to go see it? Would Shaquille O'Neal, is this a story you'd be interested in? Because I think what happened here was they said, kids will like this. Kids will go for this. That isn't the way to make a good movie.
No, and they won't, I don't think. When we come back, Lawrence Fishburne and Stephen Baldwin are convicts on the run in Fled.
Wait a minute, I'm not going anywhere.
You move when I say you move!
A fight breaks out on a chain gang, shots are fired, and two of the convicts escape in that scene from the new movie Fled. They're played by Lawrence Fishburne and Stephen Baldwin, and they're chained together in the opening scenes, but this is not a remake of the 1958 film The Defiant Ones, which had a similar setup involving Sidney Poitier and Tony Curtis. This movie is more of a thriller, but not a very serious thriller. A lot of the scenes, like this one, seem to be making fun of themselves.
Yeah, jump! What do you mean, jump? I can't swim! I only ever met a white boy that couldn't swim! Oh, yeah?
That's sort of a quote from Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid, and one of the running gags in the movie is the way the characters are always calling attention to the parallels between their situation and the movies they've seen.
And despite our appearance, I can assure you, we are not bad people.
This man, this guy's a redneck.
Don't say that!
He is. Look at him. Show him your neck, boss man.
Shut up!
Go ahead, show him your neck!
What the hell's the matter with you?
What?
Didn't you see Deliverance?
Turns out that the Baldwin character is being chased by the Cuban Mafia, who want a computer disc, another one of those computer discs that he has hidden somewhere.
Where's the disc? Where's the disc?
Coño! Hijo de la gran puta! ¿Quieres jugar conmigo?
Fled is one of those movies that 10 minutes later, you can hardly remember if you've even seen it or not. It's got a lot of action and some technical expertise, and I guess it sort of holds your attention while it's happening. I mean, something is moving on the screen, so you look to see what it is.
But what a compliment.
Who cares? The characters are simply puppets to provide an excuse for the stunts and the action sequences.
Something's moving on the screen, so you look at it.
Well, that's what I'm paid to do.
Okay. Almost not enough in the case of Fled. I thought this was terrible. And you know, let's get into the casting and the thinking behind this. The black and white guy with some racial insult humor. Aren't you a little tired of that?
Well, the thing I couldn't figure
out... I can't
out, stand... They fight each other. Here they are. They're chained together. They're being
so
chased by helicopters and by guys with guns and dogs who want to kill them.
And they pause.
And so they pause to have a fight with each other. A totally pro forma, unmotivated,
And it's black and white insult humor.
Yeah.
And it,
yeah,
you know,
yeah.
So they're going after 48 Hours. They're going after Beverly Hills Cop kind of comedy stuff. And it's very lame with these two actors in this script. Coming up, a contemporary Cinderella story set in Paris, Celestial Clockwork, is next. Clockwork, and that very arch title doesn't do justice to the upbeat nature of this Cinderella story about a Venezuelan bride who gets cold feet at her wedding right off from The Graduate, if we're talking about movie scenes, and takes off for Europe to pursue her dream of becoming an opera singer. It's Ariadna Gill as Anna, and once she reaches Paris, she finds housing with a very jealous roommate played by Ariel Dombas. Nonetheless, she pursues her dream of starring in the Cinderella opera, and she won't take no for an answer.
Una volta c'era un re che a star solo
Celestial Clockwork also features some outlandish characters who are more of help to Anna in realizing her dream. I didn't think they worked at all. I would have preferred characters who were a little bit more reality-based. But the overall tone of this film is outrageous, and the two lead women are quite captivating, as is the portrait of immigrant life in Paris. I guess I wish there had been more opera scenes than high comedy, a mixed review, a close call. But thumbs down for me.
Oh, thumbs up for me, Gene. I thought this movie was visually delightful.
It is visually delightful.
This is the kind of movie that Almodovar has been trying to make.
I agree
with you on that. His last two or three movies have not really worked. He would love to have been able to make this film.
This is a more, because it has a more human element.
Yes, and it also has some of the Latin American delight in colors. For example, the taxi cabs that change color as people take them.
Right.
The drinks that glow in the dark with the kind of green magic light. The costumes.
But let me ask you.
The great Latin music and the great opera music and that terrific performance by Ariadna Gil, who has a wonderful movie face and a great infectious person.
But let me ask you this. Didn't you want more opera? You're an opera lover. Didn't you want more opera?
I would have liked to have a little more opera.
A lot more opera.
Fortune Teller is a very small character. There are a lot of more important characters in the movie. I mean,
I thought that
is such an unimportant role that I don't know why you're even mentioning it.
I'm mentioning it because there was a style of broad comedy in this picture that I didn't think was worthy of the characters.
The whole movie is broad comedy. This movie is broad comedy from beginning to end. It's a musical comedy.
Some of it is very stylish and some of it is lame. And that is, and this isn't.
Okay, when we come back, after she made the famous Belle du Jour, Catherine Deneuve made another film with the same director that was even kinkier, and it's our video pick of the week.
Pick of the week, brought to you by Orville Redenbacher's Gourmet Popping Corn, the best part of the movies.
Not long ago, movie audiences got their first chance since the 1960s to see the legendary Belle du Jour, the famous film by Louis Buñuel, in which Catherine Deneuve played a French housewife who secretly worked in a bordello in the afternoons. Directed by Buñuel when he was 67, it became his most famous film, perhaps because it tapped a level of erotic fantasy that most movies don't understand. 3 years after Belle du Jour, in 1970, Buñuel joined up with Deneuve again to make a film that was even more darkly erotic. It was called Tristana, and it's just been released on Laserdisc in the Criterion Collection and on tape. In the film, Deneuve plays an innocent orphan who was taken in by a guardian, a much older man, played by Fernando Rey, who takes cruel advantage of her.
Dame un beso. No, así no.
As soon as she can, the young woman runs off with a handsome young artist, but then she falls victim to a tumor. She returns to the old man's household, where her leg is amputated. Despite this setback, however, her relationship with her former guardian is now far different. He is older and she is stronger, and she wants revenge for the evil things he did to her.
Lopito. Buenas noches.
¿A dónde vas?
A la cama.
Pero mujer, en una noche así vas a dejarme solo.
Hay que ver. Que tengas todavía tu edad esas ilusiones me parece increíble.
Tristana is a perverse, haunting, and brilliant film. Now available on tape and disc, and it's my video pick of the week. Now let's take another look at the movies we reviewed this week. Two thumbs down for Multiplicity, which takes an idea good for a clever short film and makes it way too long. Two more thumbs down for The Frighteners, which throws special effects at us to distract us from the fact that it's not really about anything. Two thumbs down for the dumb and obvious Kazaam, with Shaquille O'Neal as a genie who is trapped not in a bottle, but in a brainless plot. Two more thumbs down for Fled, which is the same old story again. The characters exist only as an excuse for the action and stunt work. And a split decision on Celestial Clockwork, which I thought was outrageous, funny, and a visual delight. Gene would have liked more realism and more opera. He votes thumbs down, but he had a certain amount of affection for the movie, as indeed he should have.
I do, but I just didn't have enough to recommend it. That's it for this week. Next week, we'll be back with reviews of more new movies, including A Time to Kill, starring Sandra Bullock and Matthew McConaughey, defending death row candidate Samuel L. Jackson. Also, Kingpin, with hustler Woody Harrelson grooming Randy Quaid to take on championship bowler Bill Murray. That's next week, and until then, the balcony is closed.
The Iced Teapot by Mr. Coffee.
The easy way to enjoy fresh brewed iced tea, made just the way you want it. The Iced Teapot. Ever pack a pita with fresh veggies and star-kissed tuna? It's a taste for the times. Charlie not included. Sorry, Charlie.
One loan, one payment each month, and nothing more. With a combo loan from the Money Store, you can refinance your mortgage and consolidate your bills. Call 1-800-LOAN-YES.
Blistex Lip Tone, a lip balm with proven Blistex moisturizers, plus a slight touch of color to enhance their natural pigment. Blistex Lip Tone, a touch of color, total care.